Harper Audio presents The Trident, The Forging and Reforging of a Navy SEAL Leader by Jason Redman with John R. Bruning. Read by Erik Bergmann. The mark of a man is not found in his past, but how he overcomes adversity and builds his future. Quitting is not an option. Regardless of the overwhelming odds or obstacles in your path, you always have an opportunity to overcome. It is your attitude that will determine the outcome. JCR. Forward. I first met Lieutenant J. Redmond at Bethesda Naval Hospital, where he was recuperating from his many wounds. He had posted a sign on his door that, for me, spoke for so many of our wounded in its message of courage, resolve, and optimism. I was deeply moved, and later would welcome Jay and his family to my office. As the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan raged on, he and his story would continue to inspire me. This book is about Lieutenant Redmond's journey serving his country. It is an admirably honest account of a young man going through the toughest physical training imaginable, only to discover along the way that physical toughness, tactical proficiency, and bravado are not the principal attributes of a successful warrior leader. That even more important on the battlefield are self-discipline, character, and the ability to earn the trust and confidence of one's comrades, superiors, and subordinates, and embracing personal accountability and responsibility for one's actions. This book is about that journey of discovery, before and after Jay's near-fatal wounding, a journey that ended in success due in large part, as he writes, to the steadfast support and love of his equally courageous and resolute wife. His story of healing, like combat, is the story of a team. His wife and family, doctors and nurses, his friends and fellow warriors, all of whom helped restore him. In this story, he is representative of all who have been wounded in these wars and their long road to recovery. This, too, is a story of courage and heroism. One of my senior military assistants, Vice Admiral Joe Kernan, is a SEAL and commanded SEALs in combat, and eventually commanded all SEALs. We talked a lot about Jay Redmond, and Joe once told me that the quality most needed to become a SEAL was not physical, but mental toughness. This was driven home for me one Friday morning in Coronado, California, when I stood in front of a wet, cold, and exhausted SEAL training class and informed them their Hell Week was over. It was clear that only their minds were keeping them on their feet after 6 days of near-continuous, exhausting physical exertion. But I believe Redmond's mental toughness went beyond even this and is reflected in his candor describing his flaws and deficiencies and his humble account of the people and circumstances that helped him overcome them. There already are many books on the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. There will be more, including by those who experienced the fire of combat. This story, though, is not just about a SEAL on the Iraqi battlefield, but a SEAL at war with himself and his ultimate victory. I believe his story will inspire the listener, just as it did me. Robert M. Gates, Secretary of Defense, 2006 through 2011. Author's note. The U.S. Navy SEAL teams have received unprecedented exposure over the last several years. A small segment of the community welcomed the exposure, while the vast majority wish all the attention would go away, adhering to the original humble roots of the SEAL teams, which hold on to the tenet, the deed is all, not the glory. Every man who has decided to talk has his reasons to do so. I originally chose not to, but as I began to speak to friends and leaders about the ups and downs of my personal journey, they encouraged me to share my story. Over the last 6 years, I have had ample time to reflect on my 20-year career in the SEAL teams. I served in Iraq, Afghanistan, and various hotspots in South and Central America during deployments both pre- and post-9/11. I took pride in my accomplishments, but I also forced myself to face difficult truths about who I was when I was a younger man. I thought about those lessons from my own experience as I spent long weeks in hospital beds around the United States. I wish I'd paused and been so contemplative earlier in my life. I wrote this book to be both a signpost toward a successful future and a cautionary tale of hubris. I grew up in a community of warriors, but I possessed an immaturity that lingered far too long. Hard lessons showed me the right path, and with help from admirable and respected friends, I found myself taking it. In time, I learned the true meaning of leadership and the responsibility required to lead men into battle. Today, I look back and feel supremely honored to have been with men far better than me on missions bigger than all of us. Many of the SEAL narratives written over the years have portrayed us as infallible machines. We are not. We are humans, driven to achieve and be the best at what we do, but still humans, complete with all the frailties built into our species. How we manage those frailties is one of the reasons for our success. My story shed some light on that reality and how I overcame my own shortcomings. Being a SEAL took me to the edge and beyond. It shaped me into who I am today. When I look back, I liken my path to that of an ancient sword being made into an effective combat weapon. I was selected and hardened, hammered and sharpened, until I was finally used in battle. But the rigors of combat revealed my flaws, and I was broken at one point. A second chance reforged me into a better leader and allowed me the honor of fighting alongside some of the greatest warriors this nation has ever produced. This is my journey. JCR. Prologue. Colombia, South America, 1997. I stood in the middle of Mother Nature's dumping ground for her most sadistic creations and smiled. This was the place to be. Beneath the triple canopy rainforest lurked jaguars, caiman, panthers, and the fer-de-lance viper that can kill a grown man in minutes with its deadly venom. At times, the jungle floor would be carpeted by hundreds of thousands of red ants, moving like a Roman legion as they devoured anything in their path. Vampire bats lurked in the darkness after sundown. Even the caterpillars here in the jungle could poison you. I remember when I volunteered for this deployment, one of our old salts warned me, "Don't forget, never sleep on the ground because everything in the jungle wants to kill you." I could live with the snakes and the caiman and the piranhas lurking in the eddies and pools that skirted the Guaviare River. I drew the line at the microscopic fish called the candiru that the locals told us liked to swim into a man's urethra and jab its spiked dorsal fin into the soft tissue there. I was a dedicated patriot and SEAL, but that was a boundary I didn't want to cross. I steered clear of the river whenever I could. I wouldn't even take a leak near it, lest those little demon fish could swim upstream. The small outpost we had been assigned to was the South American jungle version of a foreign legion fortress. 40 miles from the nearest settlement, it sat astride the Guaviare River, surrounded by virgin rainforest. If the things living in the river sparked alarm, the water itself wasn't much better. It moved with sludge-like speed, an ochre-colored mess of mud and jungle debris that was a nightmare for our boats to navigate. During the days, the temperature hit almost 100 degrees before noon. The humidity made us sweat like we were running marathons, even while hunkered down in the shade with water. Not that there was any ice to cool it. after our first day in country, I gave up trying to stay clean. The minute you stepped out of the shower to dry off, you'd start sweating again. By the time you dressed, your uniform was already stained from perspiration. Despite the natural and man-made dangers and heat, I loved every minute of it. Colombia was my first real deployment after I joined my first SEAL platoon. We were based out of Panama at the time, a place I also remember fondly. We had a great platoon, made up mostly of new guys, and after we finished training for the day, we'd hit the bars. We partied and trained and became brothers in that tropical paradise. One night, a few months before I found myself on my Colombian vacation, we were getting particularly festive in a Panamanian-American neighborhood in the canal zone. A fire broke out not far from us, and a fire truck came roaring through our soiree. The party had spread to the house across the street, and by the time the fire trucks arrived, at least 400 people stood in the yards and in the middle of the street between the two houses. I was on one side of the street practicing my Spanish, and a buddy of mine, Bill Jensen, was on the other. When the fire trucks, sirens blaring, horns blasting, finally managed to part the crowd like the Red Sea, I found myself within reach of the platform of the back of the truck, so I did what any young hellraiser would do. I jumped onto the back of the fire truck. Suddenly clear of the throng of people, the fire truck gunned it, and I found myself hanging on for dear life. I looked over to my right, and there was Bill hanging on and yelling like we were on a roller coaster. Who knew that two young, drunken idiot friends could have the same good, bad idea? We rode it almost all the way to the fire, whooping and hollering and having the time of our lives. Then we realized we'd have to jump off while the rig was still moving if we were going to get back to the party. That landing in the ditch next to the road still elicits a wince when I think about it. We hiked back to the party, grabbed another beer, and we carried on the rest of the night. The camaraderie and friendships I built during those months in Panama lasted the rest of my life. I will always cherish those memories. I was young, barely 22 years old, and through hard work, luck, and a lot of mental toughness, I'd joined a warrior fraternity filled with men I admired, whose skill and professionalism were unsurpassed in the field of arms. So was their ability to party during our downtime. Life at full speed in the service of our nation, I embraced every second of it. But I wanted more. I was a fresh-faced junior new guy, an E-4 intelligence specialist who'd never been tested under fire. During the 90s, there were very few hotspots around the world where you could go as a naval special warfare operator and see combat. With the drug war waging, Colombia was one of those places that you had a remote chance, and in those pre-9/11 days, combat experience was the holy grail. Few had it. The hardest chargers coveted it. When a chance to deploy to Colombia for a month came up, I jumped at it. I packed my bags and got on the bird and found myself in the middle of a jungle hellhole so sparse and run down that our fellow Americans would have condemned the place. We lived in corrugated tin Quonset huts left over from the Second World War. The place functioned as a training facility for the Colombian Army. Those Colombians were a motley group, and teaching them to fight had its moments. Though my primary duty was as an aspiring intel expert, all of us served as tactical instructors to teach some of the basic shooting and fire and movement drills on the rifle range. We used to run alongside the conscripts when they moved from station to station and took aim and fired at targets just to make sure they didn't do something stupid. They frequently did. Once, I was pacing a teenage farmer conscript with all of about 6 weeks in uniform. At one point, his rusty Belgian-made FAL rifle jammed. Instead of taking a minute to clear it properly, he grabbed the weapon by the barrel and tried to peer inside. I saw the muzzle come up toward his eye and snatched it right out of his hands before he could make a canoe out of his skull. I couldn't get too mad at him. Many of the conscripts couldn't read or write and had no life experience or knowledge of firearms. Most had lived on the fringes of the modern world their entire lives. Television was a novelty for the majority of them. It was our job to train, motivate, and professionalize the Colombian army as it struggled to win a war against the Hydra-like drug cartels that flooded America's streets with cheap cocaine. I relished the work and found some of their...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.